Thank you, sir. Like I'll be just think all this time you have been talking only on the refractive error less than 40 years, how can we correct? But we need to think of our own age people, how exactly we have to get rid of our glasses. So I'll be just talking about what are the different approaches for presbyopia and about the Presbyond. This is my financial disclosure. I'm consultant to Zeiss India. So just as a definition, presbyopia is a physiological progressive loss of accommodation affecting individuals in their middle age, regardless of any underlying refractive error, causing difficulty in sharply focusing for near vision. So what are the principles used to correct presbyopia? Once upon a time, we used to correct one eye for distance and other eye for near, something called monovision treatment. You can even, some of the examiner machine come with multifocality examiner treatment on the cornea. Even you can try increased depth of focus as we do in some of the inlays, or you can think about combined approaches or even pseudo accommodation. So this is a few treatment options for presbyopia. Of course, one of my friend from Colombia, he has got almost 1,000 patient follow-up on pharmacological drop, something called FOV tears. He has got that much of data. He thinks that with that special drops, he corrected almost more than 1,000 patient presbyopia. And of course, everybody, we all use spectacles. Of course, this is the other option. Even I think some of the companies, international company, has come with special contact lens that even you can try for presbyopic correction. But mainly I'll be talking about the surgical treatment. So as far as the option, of course, you can either think by correcting presbyopia on lens-based procedure like multifocal, trifocal, accommodating or extended range of IOL. There are different corneal procedures available in the market like presbylasic, presbyond or monovision. Still, some of my friends still doing corneal inlays. Of course, one of the company started a new technology called SupraCore. Even it was very interesting last time as a part of one of the presbyopic session, the sclerociliary complex modification, like some people are implanting scleral spacing device, even some of the laser-based procedure also been popular in the market. So multifocal intraocular lens, definitely we have been using very good lenses. The different types are there. I'm not going to talk on that, refractive, diffractive, or even combined type. Of course, now even patients with astigmatism, you have got an option to correct that, like toric multifocal. All these intraocular lenses have done more than 500 lenses. Of course, I think latest addition to this family is a trifocal intraocular lens. Definitely, it has got an added advantage of intermediate vision. But all this, whether you think about multifocal, trifocal, or any of these lenses, definitely there will be reduction in the contrast sensitivity. You need to explain to the patient. Even extended depth of focus lens also has come into the market, but once again, a lot of problems. Of course, nowadays, the last 6 months, Zeiss has come with one of the very good extended depth of focus lenses. But we have to tell the patient, definitely drop in the contrast sensitivity. And even some of the company from India has come with sort of a fake IOL with multifocality. You can implant that, then they can have a good near vision. Of course, glare is the one more side effect. Even one company from Europe has come with a sulcoplex pseudophakic supplementary IOL. Even you can correct, those are already undergone cataract surgery. So coming to the one or two points about the corneal inlays, the most common one is camera inlays, which implanted in the non-dominant eye. That the principle is it increases the depth of focus, which is similar to pinhole. You have to make a small pocket in the stroma, how you like do it in pockets in the LASIK, then you can implant that. And other two companies also available in the market, which is not FDA approved, like Presbyopia, Revision Optics. It really works on almost the same principle like camera inlays. But what are the problems with these inlays? Definitely there will be some reduction in the distance vision in the non-dominant eye. And there is a certain amount of glare also, even reduction in the contrast sensitivity. So I was talking about this sclerociliary complex modification. One of the, my friend from US, he has done more than 500 surgeries. But if you see that video, definitely I was only so much scared making 4 incision in the sclera, putting 4 PMMA segment, but his results are what he said, that amazing. And even few of my friends from Taiwan, they've been doing this particular procedure called a laser S procedure with the help of visual light erbium YAG laser that ablate the sclera, which presumed to free the ciliary muscle to contract normally. Still, some people have got a long date on this particular procedure, laser eyes. So I'll be mainly talking about what are the procedure on cornea with examiner platform. Presbyelastic, I think if you go back almost 10 years before, a lot of my friends been doing this treatment. Basically, it's a multifocal LASIK treatment that also induces spherical aberration for depth of field. But the problems with presbyelastic, every patient I used to send before, like almost around 10 years back, used to refer to one of the center, every patient they used to convince that there will be initial compromise of the distance vision, and the patient used to take a lot of time to adapt because of a multifocality cornea, night vision problems, and mainly this procedure is pupil dependent procedure. So few words about supracor. I think supracor come in the last couple of years. This is once again pupil dependent procedure performed with the help of a technolos machine, and what they do, it make use of the central near peripheral distance concept, wherein during the natural accommodation, when eye focus for near object, the pupil constrict and eye looks through the near addition. So when eye is looking at a distance, the pupil dilate and allows the peripheral rays to pass through the aspheric optimized periphery to have a improving the distance vision. But once again, this treatment, I think still not much data, probably around few of the people might be having the data of around 50 patients or 100 patients. Basically, it's a hyperopic treatment. So normally, the outcome will be like myopic, and most of the patients are unsatisfied because of uncorrected distance vision. And we have to tell the patient, you may have to do retreatment after 5 years. So this is I'm talking about the Presbyond laser blended vision. This I've been doing last 5.5 years. So the important in Presbyond is a refraction. Whether patient is myopic or hypermetropic, all my patient, we do cyclopegic refraction. That is the first point. Even lot of optometrists working in my hospital, either me or Dr. Hari is sitting here, either of us do this dominant eye testing. This is very, very important. Because when your optometrist will do this dominant eye testing, suppose if they make some mistake, you are in a soup. If you, being a doctor, you yourself do it, that's it. Once you know that which is your dominant eye, then non-dominant eye, you put 1.5 adapters. With that correction on, first you have to tell him to read for near object. The same correction, you tell him to read for distance. If the patient doesn't have any cross blur, with the same correction in the non-dominant eye, plus 1.5, can read for distance. If he can read for near, these are the patient really do very well. Certain 2 to 5% of the patient, when you start doing this micromonovision testing, they say that, doctor, please remove this something you're putting in front of my, I could able to see some cross blur. That time, probably you may try to repeat couple of times. Still patient telling after 4 or 5 times, doctor, I cannot tolerate something you're putting in this eye. Then I think you probably remove that. These are the candidates, you should not take them for this particular treatment. After talking to them, I myself convince every patient. So I never hand over this patient to the counselor, especially whenever I'm going to do this particular treatment. I myself do the dominant eye testing, micromonovision, then counseling. Then I tell them after the treatment, you never ever close each eye and see. Rather, you should only open both the eye and see. So these are the few. Then remaining all same only, routine LASIK evaluation. Zeiss gives with a fantastic software called CRS Master. Even this treatment can go along with the both MEL 80 and MEL 90 platform. These are the principle. One is monovision principle, depth of field to reduce anisometropia, spherical aberration control, vertex centration of the spherical aberration, multifocality from epithelial lenticule, then retinal image processing, neural subbation, blur adaptation and neural suppression. These are the 9 mechanisms in Presbyond. So what exactly we do in Presbyond? We make the dominant eye emmetropic and make the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 adapter. What exactly is this blend zone? The blend zone is the zone, where the vision from both dominant and the non-dominant eye meets up and binocularity retains. So, how can we increase the depth of focus? It is by creating a controlled spherical aberration in both the cornea. So what you have to do? We have to make dominant eye emmetropic, make non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 adapter, plus induction of spherical aberration in both the eyes. So by doing that, you will have good vision for distant and near. I'll get back to you once I'm coming to the results. So why Zeiss picked this particular about, why they are concentrating on this micromono vision? Because you have seen in children with amblyopia, brain tend to suppress certain image from one eye to the other eye. So this is the best way to pick the technique. So basically this treatment is bilateral treatment. You have to treat both the eyes. Always binocular vision will be much sharper than the monocular vision. See, suppose if you do Presbyond in both the eye, if you tell the patient, you tell him to close non-dominant eye and tell him to see in dominant eye, he will read 6-6. But you tell him to read, open both the eyes and read distance vision, he'll read up to 6/5. That's because of the both the eye, they have controlled the spherical aberration together the treatment. Even because of non-dominant eye, we have done myopic by 1.5 diopters. Still, because of the controlled spherical aberration, suppose in monovision, what happens? If you do only myopic by 1.5 diopters, you can expect the vision in non-dominant eye around 660 to 636 or maximum 624 parts. Because of spherical aberration in non-dominant eye, still at least 30% of my patients read up to 6-9 parts, even some of them read even 6-9 in non-dominant eye. So this is our results, 300 patients. Our case series, we have done more number of myopic, 80 patients around hypermetropic, even we do a lot of patients even with the emmetropia. But what I just want to show here, none of the eyes lost more than half a Snellen's line of vision when compared to pre-op corrected distance visual acuity. So whatever the vision they had pre-op corrected, same thing they remained in the end of the surgery. So the greatest advantage, that's what I've been showing, the different procedure, but this is the only one procedure available in the market which is not depend upon the pupil size. You can do wide range of power, like in my series, I have hypermetropic also, we have done up to 4.5, up to 5 adapters. Of course, myopia up to 8.5 adapters, depending upon the PACI value. Even we have done patients with astigmatism up to 2.5 to 3 diopters. But what I have observed in this treatment, all my patients had a very good intermediate and near vision. And more than 97% of the patients adopt this treatment very soon. And we have compared with the most of the patients in the night driving problems, there is absolutely no significant change as far as the night driving complaint is concerned. And no changes in the contrast sensitivity. So as Dan Reinstein always tell me that 97% of the patient tolerate this treatment. Of course, if the patient come back to after 5 to 8 years, even some amount of cataract changes also, he always lifts the flap and once again induce this software. He still believe that inducing spherical aberration always the best treatment for presbyopia. So in the end, I just want to put this chart, which is the best option available in the market. See, so from multifocal intraocular lens, corneal inlays, Presbymax, supracore, Presbyond. As far as the distance vision is concerned, intermediate vision, near vision, night driving problem, contrast sensitivity, adaptation, and safety. Definitely, if you compare every factor, every technology, I think probably Presbyond is the best available option available in the market. Once again, I thank Narayan Netralaya, Zeiss, and my friend Deepak and whole Carl Zeiss India team for this opportunity. Thank you, Ananda.
Sir, we know there are a lot of presbyopic patients, And this technology is since long with us. Till we know that there is no, it is not very popular, or we are not getting a good number of patients. So what we should we do, and how to counsel the patient?
So first of all, what we do, I think last time when you were also there with us, I came to Rajkot also. What exactly, once a patient, any presbyopic patient, I think our marketing should be very good. Not only like from the marketing from inside, like you need to have more and more holdings within the hospital. You need to, for every patient, even my spectacle prescription, every patient I give, there is only one ad on Presbyond. Other than Presbyond, no other ad. So once they go home also, they should think that, oh, there is one option available for presbyopia. And what the most of this optometrists they do, some of the patient, whatever ad you put inside the hospital, they never see that. Straight away they come inside and straight away they get their eye tested. What this optometrist or refractionist do, their job, just do the refraction, send the patient off. There the problem arises. In such cases, I think you have to instruct your optometrist and refractionist that every patient, wherever they are doing the refraction, they should give the option of this Presbyond. Then followed by, they should come to only Dr. Safodia for testing, so that you only can counsel them. If they go to some junior doctors or some fellows, they may not counsel them. Most of the patients come to me, hey, doctor, I came last 2 years before, since when you are having this technology? No, 3-4 years. Yeah, 2 years before, you didn't tell me only. I would have got it done 2 years before only. Probably, I think, see, in international societies, what they say that presbyopia is the one hidden market none of us been really taken out. I think if you really work on that, as far as the marketing part is concerned, I think
I think we are the reason, actually. We were telling that after 40, no LASIK. Now we are telling we are ready for them also.
Yes, sir. This is what we are. I think we only started like that. After 40, no more LASIK.
Yeah. Dr. Kudlu, for how long the effect stays?
Sir? See, like, my patients are...
It may not last
long. No, sir. Like, see, I'll tell you. Now we are doing a non-dominant eye, making myopic by 1.5 diopters, plus some amount of spherical aberration. So if you calculate the amount of spherical aberration and this thing, patient will have an effect of almost around 2.25 to 2.5 diopters of near vision effect. If you do it even at the age of 45, that should remain forever, unless and until patient should not have any lenticular changes. I mean, lenticular myopia or hypermetropia. So you need not have to repeat this test, this treatment. My case, 5.5 years follow up, we have not done not a single case retreatment. Of course, counseling very important. Any flex of nuclear changes or cataract, I will not pick them for this particular treatment.
Many a times, Dr. this Malkan. Lenticular issues are missed unless you do the abrometry, especially with eye tracy like machine. Do you do such test?
No, I never do abrometry. But what I decided, like, see, what I used to think, that some patient already having a pre-existing some negative spherical aberration in the cornea. You've seen some of the patient, you are already done a regular IOL with a zero spherical aberration, intraocular lens you implant. Then after the surgery, patient, in spite of putting monofocal lens also, patient coming to you and telling, doctor, after your surgery, I don't want glass for near vision only. That is just because of they're already having the there is spherical aberration. So what we do for all the patients, we are having a wavefront Waska analyzer. We even calculate the amount of spherical aberration already there. What we found out, if the patient is already having a significant amount of negative spherical aberration in the cornea, when you are doing it, won't induce that much. It will little bit adjust that spherical aberration, whatever is there in the cornea, then it gives the treatment in both the eye together.
Dr. Krishna. My longest follow-up, just to answer that question, is 9 years. Patient is about 66 now, and he is doing well. He is 6'6" and 6". So he has no difficulty driving.
9 years.
Yeah. And what do you do for people who don't tolerate that? Do you always do a fixed 1.5 anisometropy?
No. What I do, normally, see, my case series, so patient, I pick them for, even there are some patients, even the age of 37, 38, early presbyopic. So early presbyopic, what I do, I never put 1.5 diopters. Rather, I tried putting plus 1.25. I reduced 0.25 or even 1 also. And my case series, most of the Dr. Ganesh place, I think they are telling their hypermetropic patients are doing really well. But my case series, just this week we did two cases. Hari is also here. Both myopic patient, they are doing extremely, extremely well. But
so in the pre-presbyopic people, like you said, no, I sometimes will not do a big anisometropia, just maybe 0.25 or 0.5, but that helps to at least delay the onset of presbyopic symptoms for them. So I don't always do this fixed 1.5. Sometimes I will titrate that.
Yeah.
And the myopes and hyperopes both
are. See, 37 years, 39 years, I may reduce to 1.25, but after 50, I normally increase from 1.5 to 1.75.
According to the software, it goes out of range, but even I do that.
Yeah. After 50, I increase for 1.75. Then amount of spherical aberration, it will almost gives around 2.25 to 2.5 effect to the patient. I think your follow-up is, I think, longest follow-up, and the patients are very happy.
But this particular age group, they have multiple issues, like dry eye is very common. Do you exclude them while doing this?
Which one?
Diabetics and dry eye people.
Diabetic, normally, see, I have done around 10 to 15 diabetic patients. Normally, we ask them 6 months follow-up, then we ask them HbA1c report. And those are patients, strict diabetic control only we do. But such patient, at least a couple of times we dilate and we look at their lens. Some changes, lenticular changes also, we never pick them. If there is no lenticular changes, then only you counsel them for presbyopia. Oldest age, our case series, we have done, I think, picked one patient for 62 years. We normally do around 55 years, but in Dan Reinstein, he has done for 74 years also. Even surgeons from Italy and Spain, they had a data year on, they are doing after 74, there is no cataract changes. But normally, me, Dr. Hari, we together around 55, 60. In Indian case scenario, after 55, 60, definitely if you dilate, there will be some amount of cataract changes. So such patient, normally we give a, other better options are there, like extended depth of focus, depending upon their, whatever the job they are doing.
So,
about
could
eyes?
We just continue with that? I invite
one
the
last question.
No, I'll just invite the. Okay.
Do you do it this in pseudophakic eyes?
Yeah, three patients we did for pseudophakia. Of course, pseudophakic patient also with the same software we can go. Only thing is, I don't educate from a blade presbyond. We opt them for a femto presbyond because the amount of pressure with the blade normally it may have. But patients are doing really well. Unless and until, if the pupil, eccentric pupil and all, if it is there, then we don't opt them for this presbyopia. Pseudophakic IPCL. I think Saurav Patwardhan, as far as I remember, he has used a couple of patient, this one, multifocal IPCL, but I don't have any personal experience. What, Saurav?
The results are good, but I think the main thing is once you tell that after IPCL, patient is going to develop cataract. I'm talking about the phakic IPCL. I don't have any other patient opting for presbyopic IPCL.
Sir, just this morning when we came in flight, Dr. Malkan, that gentleman, one of my pseudophakic presbyopic patients was with us in the flight. And I don't know if how many, some of them heard that he was telling other patients, that another doctor traveling, that I'm just so happy. He's 5 years post-op. And so pseudophakes are also doing quite well.
Yeah, I think Zeiss has to market more and more regarding this presbyopia. Definitely it is much, much fantastic treatment compared to anything.
I need to tell that presbyopia is also available. It's not only smile.
Yeah, thank you.
So we continue that.